Hi guys, thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum, and I am here today at the National Firearms Center, part of the Royal Armouries in Leeds, England. And I am here courtesy of ARRES, Armament Research Services, and we are taking a look at a very cool, mechanically extremely complex and weird Russian rifle. This is a Nikonov AN-94. These were developed as part of Russia's attempt to develop something to replace the AK-74. And these were actually formally adopted by the Russian military, given their equivalent of an NSN number, a GRUA, a GRAU, something like that. So they are formally used by the Russian military, but they were never used very much. They have seen very little actual active service. I suspect largely because they are probably ridiculously expensive and they are ridiculously complex. Now, what you get for all that complexity is a two-shot burst that feels like one shot. The idea with this actually in many ways kind of goes back to the US SPIW program, where the attempt was, how do we increase hit probability with the infantry rifle? And one of the ideal things is, what if we could have a two-round burst where both rounds are fired before the recoil impulse hits the shooter and disrupts their point of aim? You could do this, for example, by having two bullets in one cartridge case, which is something the US experimented with, or you could do it by firing two cartridges so fast that the recoil hasn't hit the shooter by the time the second round is fired. That's what this rifle does, and it does it through this really complex mechanism whereby it's both gas and recoil operated. The gist of this is, you kind of have two things moving here simultaneously. You have a bolt cycling, and you have the barrel and this internal receiver unit all cycling at the same time. And in two-round burst mode, what happens is the bolt actually cycles twice before the recoil-operated bits hit the back of the receiver, because it's when the barrel assembly and the internal receiver unit hit the back of travel, that's when the recoil impulse is transferred to the shooter. So if you can have the bolt cycle twice during that time frame, you get two rounds out of the barrel on one point of aim before the aim is disrupted. The way this works is actually largely due to this wacky looking muzzle device, which delays the recoil of the barrel assembly. So there's a gas operating system inside here as well, which looks vaguely like an AK gas system. And the gas system, when you first fire, the bullet goes out, the gas system starts to move the bolt, and it also starts to cycle inside this muzzle device. The bolt moves backward, extracts around, ejects it, and starts to go forward again, right about as the barrel assembly actually gets moving. Then the bolt is all the way forward, hammer strikes a second round, and the bolt cycles backwards again as the whole internal mechanism is moving backwards. By the time that second round is ejected, the barrel assembly is at its rearward of travel, the bolt is at the rear of travel, then the sight picture lifts from recoil, but you've already had both rounds fire. Now, what makes this very difficult is, if you think about it, you'll realize that in order to do that, you have to feed two rounds out of the magazine. The problem is, this thing isn't going far enough to do that. The way Nikonov addressed this problem is to actually have a two-stage feed system, where you have a round in the magazine that gets fed up onto a lifter, and from the lifter into the chamber. That is also why the magazine is angled off to the side. You may not be able to see it well from that angle, but if I point the rifle at you, you can see that the magazine is very clearly canted off to the right. What happens in the two-round burst mode is, when the bolt is making that first stroke backwards, there's a cable and a wheel and a counter recoil thing. So as the bolt goes back, it pulls sort of a faux bolt forward, which cycles around out of the magazine onto the lifter. That way, when the bolt is at the rear and then goes forward, it has a second round already halfway into the chamber that it can load. This is clear as mud? I think it probably is. So let's go ahead and take this one apart and take a closer look at how these components actually work. So first off, before we get started, I do want to point out that this is actually a factory deactivated AN-94. So it's not fully functional. They've taken the head of the bolt and the head of the cartridge lifter sort of thing. I'll show you when we get there. They've taken those and cut them off at an angle, and they have plugged the barrel. So I unfortunately cannot demonstrate this with dummy cartridges because the barrel's plugged and the bolt face is cut off, but we can still take it apart exactly like it should be taken apart. First, however, let's take a quick look at the markings. We have right here that MMG indicates that it is a factory deactivated rifle, and then AN-94 serial number and a Chevsk manufacturing mark. The magazine release is one of the few parts that is basically the same as an AK-74, as is the magazine. These are, of course, chambered for the 5.45x39 cartridge. The magazine just rocks out of the receiver there, although, as we pointed out, the magazine is slightly canted off to the side. We have a safety located here to the side of the trigger group. Zero is fire, and that other character is safe. All right, we then have a selector lever just above the trigger guard, and there are three positions. The farthest one back here, AB, or Avtomat, is full auto, and on standard full auto, this fires at about 600 rounds a minute, so pretty typical. Then the next selector position forward is two. That is, of course, the special two-round burst mode, which is extremely high rate of fire. That's about 1,800 rounds a minute for those two. And then all the way forward is semi-auto mode. The rear sight is also a particularly interesting and unusual style. It's mounted at about a 45-degree angle, and it has five separate apertures, kind of like an HK system. 7, 6, 5, 4, and 2. So a couple, whatever your range is, set the dial to that, and then you have an aperture sight. The front sight is kind of goofy and weird. It's a normal small front post, but it's in this sort of oblong protective thing with a notch up at the top. I suspect this has some purpose, but I don't know exactly what it is. Now, disassembly is going to begin with this lever. I have to lift that up off its pin and rotate it just past 90 degrees down. So we'll take that with a dummy cartridge, lift it up, there we go, and then we can rotate that all the way down. The trick to getting the top cover off is to use force from the charging handle. So you want to hold the charging handle forward, also hold the barrel assembly forward so that it doesn't move, and then see if I can get this. There we go. I have popped it just slightly forward here. Now I can pull the top cover the rest of the way off. With that out, now I can actually pull the entire rest of the action out of the gun by pulling this slightly up, and then this internal receiver unit all comes out. All right, next up, we are going to take off the pistol grip assembly, which is also the fire control assembly. In order to do that, I need to rotate this lever down 90 degrees. And in order to do that, of course, it's kind of locked in place by the stock button. So I have to push the stock button all the way in. This is a little tricky, and you won't be able to see it behind my gloves. There we go. With the button down, I can get that lever started. Then I can pop it the rest of the way around to there. And now the trigger assembly comes out. We'll take a closer look at this in just a moment. And then this is a very important component. This is the lifter. This is what picks up the second round from the magazine and holds it halfway between the magazine and the chamber for that two-round burst feed mechanism. So just a quick pause here to give you some perspective. The magazine's here, and I've got the lug lined up here where the rifle would be at rest. Notice that the bolt handle is here. So the chamber is here. The magazine is back here. We have space for an entire second cartridge sitting right here in the middle of the receiver. That's critical. That's an essential element of how the two-round burst works. Now looking inside, you can see that right at that point, we have this lifter mechanism. And that comes out of the receiver by pushing in this button and then sliding the lifter forward. I can slide that out of its rails, lift it up. There's not a whole lot to this, but it's critically important to the gun working. So now this is the internal receiver unit. It's got the muzzle device, it's got the barrel. Here's our gas port right there, gas cylinder, gas piston. Bolt is right here. And you'll notice that there's a little wire cap, and this wire runs around the wheel all the way down to this thing right here. Now, this thing, which I believe has been cut off at a 45 degree angle as part of the demil process, when I pull the bolt handle back, it goes forward because it's connected to, through this wire, it's connected to the bolt. This, its function is to pull around out of the magazine and up onto that secondary lifter as the bolt is coming backwards. That means, in a normal gun, the bolt has to come all the way back and eject a case, and then it has to push a cartridge forward. We have to be able to do that twice within a single recoil stroke of the action. So it's essential to have some second device to feed the number two cartridge into the system. Note that we also have AN94 here, DAC AN94, on the internal receiver unit, as well as its serial number. Now, I can take some more of this apart by taking tension off of the wheel. So if I take the secondary lifter here and just push it forward, I can take tension off the wire, which allows me to remove the wheel. Then I can thread this back through its guide. We can take that off. Now we have the bolt disconnected from the lifter. This is our actual bolt mechanism. Notice that it has its own recoil spring. So we've got actually three recoil springs in this gun. We have a spring for the bolt. We have a spring here to put tension on the wheel and the secondary lifter. And then we also have a return spring for the barrel, which is located right there. You can see that oval wire hook. That connects to a lug on the barrel. In fact, it connects to that hook right there to pull the whole barrel, the whole internal receiver unit forward after the recoil action has taken place. Now we can take this recoil assembly out by pushing in and lifting up. Really heavy duty buffer assembly there, and recoil spring for the bolt. We can then take the bolt and lift it up and out somehow. There we go. Actually, I'll take this out first. This is the hammer. This is vaguely similar to a ricing in that you have this traveling hammer, which is an important element to how the gun can fire both two-shot bursts and regular semi and full auto. We'll touch on that in a moment. So I can take the hammer out, and then I can pull the bolt carrier back. Here is our bolt carrier and the bolt. That's also vaguely AK-like. Note that, unfortunately, they have cut the bolt face off at 45 degrees as part of the demil process. There also should be an extractor in here, but it has been removed as well. If it's a deactivated gun, it really doesn't need an extractor. Now, I'm going to leave this secondary loader in the gun here because it's kind of a mess to take out, but it also has a recoil spring there. I'm gonna grab my gloves. And it simply travels forward and backward opposite of the bolt. Now, a lot of people look at this and they think this is a counter recoil system, which is what the Russians call it, because you do have this wheel and you do have what looks like, well, what is counter rotating reciprocating motion as the gun fires. However, this is not there to absorb recoil. I think that's the main misconception with this gun. People think that it fires without disrupting the shooter's point of aim by having some sort of mechanical system that balances out the recoil. In actual fact, what this is doing is making use of the bolt's rearward energy to simultaneously push a cartridge halfway forward into the secondary feed system. What makes the gun fire, what allows the gun to fire twice without changing the shooter's point of impact or point of aim, is that this whole unit is recoiling backwards, and the shooter isn't going to feel it until this stops. And this doesn't stop until after it's fired two rounds, thanks to the fancy double feed mechanism. Now, the slide hammer here has also been demilled. This round cutout at the bottom shouldn't be there. That prevents it from actually striking a firing pin, although there isn't a firing pin. What happens is the bottom of this has a sear right there, or a sear surface, that interacts with this catch. That catch interacts with this button, so when I pull that down, the sear drops. This The main hole on the back is its recoil spring, or its main guide spring. You can put that in right there. So this moves to this point forward and gets held by the sear until this goes down, which allows this slide hammer to go forward, hit the bolt and hit the firing pin and fire. The trigger mechanism does that by simply pulling down on this lever. So this lever is going to hold on to this pin like this. And pull it down like that. So the fire control selector on the trigger unit cycles this falling catch forward and backward. And what that does is it means that this ledge interacts with the sear here at different positions during the internal receiver unit's rearward travel. And that's what allows it to fire differently in two-round burst, semi-auto, and traditional full-auto. Thank you for watching, guys. I hope you enjoyed the video. I certainly really appreciated finally getting a chance to take apart one of these things and see how this commie space magic actually works. I guess they're not actually commies, but Russian space magic actually works. If you did enjoy this, a couple things you should do. You should check out Armament Research Services blog post, where there will be high-resolution pictures of this and its internals. You can see the link to that down in the description text below. And also make sure to get in contact with the National Firearm Center, part of the Royal Armouries. Their collection, which includes this AN-94, is not open to the general public, but it is available by appointment to small arms researchers and other interested parties. And as long as I don't let that fall over, they'll let me come back too. Thanks for watching.